Well, welcome to the 700 Club. In their frantic quest to get some kind of a health care bill, Senate Democrats are trying a new tactic. They want to give states the option to include the public option.
But new reports are raising questions about the government's ability to handle even basic health programs. Here's reporter Jennifer Wishon.
Congress's fix for health care now has a sharper focus after Majority Leader Harry Reid revealed that government-run health insurance, or a public option, will be part of the Senate plan.
The best way to move forward is to include a public option with the opt-out provision for states. Under this concept, states will be able to determine whether the public option works well for them and will have the ability to opt out.
Reid, who faces a tough re-election battle next year, is taking a gamble. The public option is controversial among Americans and lawmakers on both sides of the aisle, and even Reid admits he does not yet have the 60 votes needed to avoid a Republican filibuster. And some question whether or not the government should be entrusted with health care when it's having problems with more basic tasks like delivering vaccines for the swine flu. Americans from California to Oklahoma and Illinois are waiting in lines for hours, only to get turned away when the clinic's supplies run out.
I thought I'd be able to get the vaccine at my children's pediatrician. It hasn't been offered there. County clinics have been canceled and overwhelmed by lines.
Even Americans most at risk, like pregnant women, are having a hard time getting vaccinated. And for some, that's a very real concern.
I really don't want to take my daughter very many places. I don't want to be around kids. I don't know if she's going to get sick, and I don't want her to be sick. I'm like really nervous. I'm scared.
This epidemic is continuing to progress, and more people are going to emergency rooms. More people are going to hospitals, and sadly, more people are dying.
And now a new report from the Government Accountability Office shows the Food and Drug Administration has allowed drugs for cancer and other diseases to stay on the market even when follow-up studies revealed they did not extend patients' lives. But despite that, FDA officials say they have no plans to get more aggressive.
The FDA says the report paints an overly negative picture of the agency's accelerated approval process of drugs used to treat the most serious diseases like HIV. But according to the report, since the program began, the FDA has never pulled an unsuccessful drug off the market. More reasons why critics will ask if the government can handle the nation's health care. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News.
Thanks, Jennifer. Well, you look at those crowds. If that isn't enough to scare you away from this public option, they think the government is now going to handle your health. They can't even get out vaccines for people. And they've had a good year or better to get the supply together, and they don't have it yet.
Well, and then actually telling people that they need to get it, but being unable to make it available.
Yeah, and then they come in these gigantic crowds and have to wait for hours, and that's the way it's going to be with your health care all the way up and down the line, ladies and gentlemen. You watch and see. Hey, by the way, today is Tuesday, right?
Yes, all day.
You sure?
Yes.
All right. Well, a week from now is going to be Election Day in Virginia and New Jersey. So I just want to tell people to do your patriotic civic duty and be sure to vote.
Be knowledgeable. There are lots of wonderful voter guides in the paper these days.
All the above. I'm not saying who to vote for. Just vote. Make sure you're an informed voter.
Yes, sir.
You ready?
I'm ready.
You going to fulfill your patriotic?
I am ready.
All right. Well, Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories in the CBN newsroom. Lee?
Pat, more Americans call themselves conservative than any other political name. 40% say they're conservative, 36% moderate, and only 20% liberal, according to the latest Gallup poll. It's the first time conservatives have outnumbered moderates since 2004. Americans are also growing more conservative on specific issues. 45% say there's too much government regulation of business and industry. A record 42% would like to see labor unions have less influence in the country. And 53% want the government to, quote, promote traditional values. Gallup says this growing conservatism could have important implications for next year's midterm elections, Pat.
I don't think there's any question about it, and I think that the Democrats are going to run from the liberal label as far as they can get, and of course, Republicans would do well to label themselves conservative. But these basic issues are coming down to where the rubber meets the road, and those who will accept a liberal label, are going to find themselves out of office. Lee?
Some leading senators are trying to rein in Washington's massive spending. Republican Judd Gregg and Democrat Kent Conrad are proposing a panel that will review government spending and taxes and try to find bipartisan ways to stop the country from drowning in debt. Both senators are members of the Senate Budget Committee. They're suggesting a panel with 8 Democrats and 8 Republicans. It would take 12 votes to agree on any plan, but House and Senate leaders oppose the idea. And speaking of spending, the government approved an economic stimulus bill costing more than $750 billion earlier this year. But unemployment is still climbing, and some critics wonder if the stimulus was worth it. Here's Carolyn Castleberry.
With new construction projects underway and federal money helping the states to avoid layoffs, the White House says the stimulus plan is working.
Don't just take my word for it. Analysts from Moody's to IHS Global Insight to the Economic Policy Institute and others all estimate the Recovery Act has created or saved between 500,000 and 750,000 jobs.
But not all economists are buying it.
I find it very difficult to believe that 750,000 jobs have been created by stimulus money that has mostly gone unspent.
Only about 10% of the $787 billion of the stimulus has been spent so far. The president signed the stimulus plan in February, and since then, the rate of job loss has steadily declined. But overall, jobs are still being cut. In fact, more than 2.3 million Americans have lost their jobs since the stimulus went into effect. That's a big chunk of the 7 million jobs lost since the recession started last year.
There will be some impact. In 2010 and 11, we'll likely have about 2.5 to 3 million temporary jobs. But we've lost permanently 7 million private sector jobs. As a consequence, this is simply not repairing what's broken in the economy.
Carolyn Castleberry, CBN News.
Pat, what do you think?
Well, what I think is, again, this is the gang that can't shoot straight. Months and months, they've had this bill passed. Yet they can't even get the money out the door. It shouldn't be too hard to write a check. I mean, that's one of the easiest things to do. But oh no, they have to have all kinds of bells and whistles and bureaucracy and levels of authority and checks and balances and all this. And when it's all finished, the money doesn't go out and people lose their jobs. So people will say the stimulus isn't working. Well, it hasn't really been tried, but it's not our fault. Lee?
Pat, President Obama says he will not rush to decide about sending more troops to Afghanistan, that despite warnings from top generals and Senate Republicans that time is short. 14 Americans were killed in Afghanistan Monday, and at Jacksonville's Naval Air Station, the president told U.S. sailors he will be cautious about sending more service members over there.
And while I will never hesitate to use force to protect the American people or our vital interests, I also promise you this. And this is very important as we consider our next steps in Afghanistan. I will never rush the solemn decision of sending you into harm's way. I won't risk your lives unless it is absolutely necessary.
Pat, there is some speculation that the president will decide in a few weeks to send more troops in, but not to the level that General McChrystal would like.
He ran for president for a couple of years. He had a campaign that talked over and over again about Afghanistan being the key place and Iraq being the wrong place. He had it all talked about, and then he comes into office, and he's been into office low these many months, and he's got his team all together, and he's not going to, quote, rush a decision. He can't make a decision. And if he ought to say, well, we're not going to do it, and that would be fine, but he obviously hasn't made up his mind. Well, CBN's Chuck Holston recently returned from Afghanistan, and Lee, you can tell us about what he had to say.
Yeah, I talked to Chuck, and he traveled on helicopters similar to the one that crashed on Monday over there, and I talked to him about that.
What I've been told so far, Lee, the crash in the north that resulted in the deaths of 10 people was a part of a unit that I was actually embedded with just several weeks ago in Afghanistan, and several of those killed were men that we were with while we were there. I can tell you these guys it's the first DEA casualties in Afghanistan since 2005, and they're going to be bringing these guys home in the next few days, and they're really mourning right now.
So these are men that you got to know personally on these missions. Is that right?
That's right.
Chuck, there has been speculation as to whether there might have been a mechanical malfunction on at least one of these on one of these helicopters. You say that you saw lots of problems with helicopter maintenance simply because of the tempo of operations over there and such a harsh environment. Tell us about that.
That's right, Lee. The maintenance people are doing all they can to keep the helicopters they have running. The problem is they just don't have enough helicopters. And so, you know, with the op tempo that they have going there, they have to keep those helicopters running day and night. And there were several, especially down in the south with the Marines that I was on, that were clearly in need of more maintenance. And, you know, they're doing the best they can, but they just don't have enough machines. And I've been told in the last 60 days they've doubled the number of helicopters that are there, and they're not even close to the number that they really need to get the job done right now.
And we will have more from Chuck Holton on Afghanistan later in the 700 Club. A legal battle is brewing in Houston over the city council's practice of praying before meetings. A woman by the name of Kay Staley has filed a federal lawsuit against the city. She says the long-held tradition of opening the meetings with prayer violates the Constitution.
Just because it's always been doesn't make it right. There are a lot of people that feel exactly the same way I do. Most people are afraid to come out and say anything because they're afraid of their jobs or their friends.
The suit alleges that allowing prayers of any faith violates the so-called separation of church and state. One city council member, though, calls the lawsuit frivolous.
I think they're publicity stunts. I don't think it's a genuine concern. You know, no one has come before to do this at the city of Houston that I'm aware of.
I think that's what we need to do is to review the lawsuit and see what they're alleging and then look at our practices and our policies and make sure that we are in conformity with current law.
In 2003, Staley sued to have a Bible monument removed from a Harris County courthouse. That's in Houston as well. 3 years later, an appeals court ordered the monument removed, Pat.
Well, it makes me sick at the stomach when I see the misappropriation and the misapplication of the Establishment Clause of the United States Constitution. There's nothing in our Constitution that says we need to have, quote, separation of church and state. It just isn't in the Constitution. It existed in the Soviet Union Constitution, but not in ours. And we have added to the Constitution something that doesn't exist. And people say, oh, yes, separation of church and state, that's in the Constitution. No, it's not. Separation of sectarian religion from the public forum is indeed part of the Constitution, but not the other. And when you think that one weirdo, one person who hates God, one atheist, whatever, can tear away the fabric of religious belief of our society is something terrible. I believe in people having their day in court, but I do think that we should have majority rule. A majority says we think praying before we get going with a city council meeting is a good thing. Lee?
Well, Pat, just when you thought political correctness couldn't get any more absurd, along comes a controversy brewing at Penn State University, and it all centers around a T-shirt that won a student design competition to promote school spirit there. It's white with a blue stripe similar to the Nittany Lions' distinctive football helmets. Penn State is printed through the stripe, as you can see by that T-shirt there, and some folks say that looks too much like a cross. Six complaints have been filed with the university, including one from the Anti-Defamation League. But one university official tells Fox News, six complaints is not a controversy. Now, the T-shirts have been selling like hotcakes, we understand, and we haven't heard of any plans to pull the T-shirts from the store shelves. If you live in Norway and you want to know how much your neighbor paid in taxes last year, all you have to do is go online. The government reveals that information every year. Supporters say the practice is important to keep an open democracy, but opponents say tax records are a private matter between the taxpayer and the government. They claim criminals can go online to find targets, and children of low-income families are teased about what their parents earn. Pat?
Well, Lee, I don't run Norway, so I think they have a lot of oil money up there, and they've done a pretty good job. But I don't think opening your records to the general public is a good thing. That's one thing that we have in this country is the sanctity of the tax returns. An agent can go to jail if he reveals what's in somebody's tax return.
What's the point of making them public? That's kind of...
Well, maybe it promotes democracy, but it also promotes crime and shame.
Yeah, really.
Well, in some Muslim countries, women are not allowed to interact with men who are not family members. And that creates a problem for the U.S. military in places such as Afghanistan, where nearly half the population is female. So the Marines are taking steps to reach out to this key segment of the Afghan society. Chuck Holton has more from southern Afghanistan.
As fighting continues to rage in Afghanistan, the search is on for ways to win the hearts and minds of the Afghan people. Toward that end, the Marines are employing a secret weapon in the heavily contested South that they hope will turn the tables on Taliban influence there. From a distance, this might look like an average squad out on patrol, but look closer, and you may be surprised to find that some of these Marines are women. They're part of a female engagement team here on the front lines, reaching out to a part of the Afghan population that until now has been ignored.
48% of the Afghan population is female, and the infantry units cannot engage that percentage of the population, but we can.
First Lieutenant Hannah Sides leads the team.
We've had 4 patrols so far. We've gone out and engaged multiple females.
He says about 3 or 4 of our women can go inside.
We've been received very, very well. We take a native speaker with us. They're thrilled to have people actually care about them and want to come see how they're doing. They're breaking fast right now, so they were making dinner for tonight because everybody's celebrating Ramadan. So we only spoke for a minute and told them about the medical clinic that we're having tomorrow.
Their translator, an Afghan-American woman named Holly Jilani, believes this strategy is vital.
If we don't have those women to go into the communities and connect to the women, we're not going to be able to effectively succeed. Those are the people whom I've always considered our natural allies, and yet we're not getting to them.
So far, this approach has been very well received, and Afghan women aren't shy in sharing their opinions about the war.
And what a lot of women are telling us is that, look, for God's sake, get all these guys to stop fighting. Can't we do something? Can't we women do something?
And these female Marines are definitely doing their part. Living conditions are tough, with extreme temperatures and lots of dust. But there's no special treatment, and it's not expected.
We love camping. We're Marines. I wear the same Marine Corps emblem. I am a Marine. If you look at any of the females around here, they'll tell you first I'm a Marine.
Be that as it may, Lieutenant Sides has a husband back at home who might not be as enthusiastic about her frontline tour of duty, especially considering that this unit lost 5 Marines in combat over the summer.
He worries about me, but if he didn't worry about me, he wouldn't love me, so.
These girls are absolutely awesome. We have to go in and assure people that we are not the enemy. We are not the former Soviet Union, that we're actually coming to their houses, not just as medics and caregivers, we're actually coming to them as friends. And that is what I find so wonderful. The war in this case is over the souls of a community. There is no cut and run anymore.
Chuck Holton, CBN News in southern Afghanistan.
It's an amazing situation. Well, your hat's off to these women. They're very courageous, and I don't like splitting up families. I don't think taking mothers away from their children and sending them to Afghanistan is a good policy. We do it, and the feminists insist on it, but I think it's stupid.
Well, you know, I think it's been in play for a long time now, and a lot of women really feel called to that. I mean, in this situation, they can accomplish something that a man cannot.
But if they've got little children at home, they should be with the little children and not over in Afghanistan talking to Muslim women. But in any event, we've got enough for those good Marines. And, you know, it's amazing. There's no such thing as an ex-Marine. I'm a Marine. I once said, I'm an ex-Marine. They said, no way. There's no such thing as an ex-Marine. You're a Marine. And those women are Marines, and good for them. All right.
Here.
The Washington, D.C. City Council is facing opposition to its plan to legalize same-sex marriage. Hearings are underway, and hundreds of people have signed up to speak out. Local pastors say the issue should be left to voters. But city leaders say it's their decision to make and no vote is needed. Still, same-sex marriage opponents are preparing to turn to the courts if city leaders deny their request for a ballot initiative. The new homecoming queen at the College of William & Mary in Virginia is a young man who considers himself transgender. Jesse Vassold was crowned last weekend at the school's homecoming football game. The Virginia Gazette reports that Vassold wants people to use gender-neutral pronouns when referring to him. For example, the word Z instead of he or she, and the word Zer instead of him or her. And we're not making this up. He's a member of the Campus Organization for Homosexuals and Transgenders. He also helped bring the Sex Workers Art Show to the campus. William & Mary's president says a transgender homecoming queen is just fine. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbn.com.